I'm Nick Simmons, County Extension Director for Escambia County, Florida. I'm joined here today with Rick O'Connor. He is our Sea Grant agent. We're both with UF IFAS Extension. We're talking about one of the many things that we deal with as Extension faculty, and that's working with invasive species. We're talking about some of these things through NISAW week, and we deal with invasive species in all parts of the Panhandle of Florida, but throughout Florida itself.
Oh, yeah,
we're kind of a melting pot of invasive species.
Ground zero.
And, so one of the that we really focused on, and Rick's been a big proponent of this project over the past few years, is Beach Vitex. Obviously, we're out here at Pensacola Beach. It's a beautiful day, but we've got a really good example here of this plant, and I'm gonna let Rick talk a little bit more about it, some of the characteristics of it, identification, and some of the management and the project that you've been working on.
Sure. Yeah, this is Beach Vitex. Its scientific name is Vitex rotundifolia. There are other forms of Vitex in the county that are not invasive, such as the chase tree. But this one is, and to designate it as invasive, it's got to be causing an issue or a problem. And the big problems for this plant are actually out here in the dunes. Once the seeds start growing and spreading, as you can see, there's a couple of things about this. Most of these native plants we have out here in the dunes have a fibrous root system, and so they can trap the sand and actually build dunes. Mm-hmm. Vitex doesn't have that. It has a tap root, so you're looking at this, but there's actually one, maybe two tap roots, and as you come over here, you can see where the vine's getting a little bit thicker. That kind of helps you. I don't know if we'll be able to show them.
Yeah,
you can see it's getting a lot thicker, but we have found it here on the beach where the diameter of this stuff was about, you know, almost 2 inches. And so once it gets to that stage, you can follow that, and there's a main tap root that goes down. So it doesn't stabilize dunes as well as our native plants. That's a problem. The other problem we may have with it, the seeds, the seed doesn't come till fall, but we don't know whether the native organisms that live out here, wildlife, particularly things like beach mice, might deal with this. We don't know how they might deal with this. This plant is what we call liliopathic. We talked about that with the cogan grass. So it will release compounds that actually absorb water away from the neighboring plants. Those die, and as you can see, the plant begins to spread. And again, they'll have a main tap root, so when it spreads across the surface, and it eventually will take over the dunes. So then you've got a dune that's not quite as stable. If you got a protected beach mouse in your county, then that guy is, you know, in potential in trouble because this food source that it needs is not there. So that's another problem for this thing. We don't know. We're starting to get literature now because it will grow on the Gulf side. These vines you see right here in the summertime, it's May at the moment, but these vines during the summertime can grow up to 20 feet in 1 week. There is one property down the beach. Gentleman had it in the front and the backyard, and it was growing so fast in the summer, he literally had to cut it every week to be able to get his car out of the garage. So it's a very aggressive growing plant. And on the Gulf side, the question was whether or not it would impact sea turtle nesting. The females are going to come up, they're going to lay the eggs. These vines grow over the top of the nest. It might, if it becomes this thick, this dense, it might literally entrap the hatchlings in there. And now there is some science up on the East Coast that has happened. So there's a variety of reasons why we want to try to control this thing.
So Rick, you have some citizen scientists that have helped you, some volunteers, but if somebody was out here, how would they go about identifying it? It has some very distinguished characteristics, but if somebody was just passing by, what's the easiest way to detect that is Beach Vitex?
Okay, there's a couple of things that I look for. Number one, it's hard to see probably on the video, but the coloration of the leaf is sort of what we call a bluish green compared to some of the native stuff that's more of a green. So if you look up and down the beach, sometimes you'll see it. It just doesn't look right. The coloration is different, which means I'll go check that out. And then when you walk up to take a look at it right now, we're talking late spring, early summer, it's in bloom. The blossoms of this thing are purple or lavender color. We don't have too many plants out here on the beach that have that coloration. And as we get deeper in the summer, these blossoms will get tall, maybe an inch high. And there are florets that come off of it. And it's just a brilliant lavender color, and that stands out. So when you see that, you're like, oh, maybe I need to go check that out. The leaves themselves are ovate. They're not long and thin. They're kind of almost round. And then of course you see the vines. That's the other thing. You can see this vine running off of here. You see that vine running off out there into the dune. So again, we don't have too many native plants. We've got some, but most of the native plants don't do that. So between the coloration, the flower, and the vine, they should at least narrow it down. Again, you can always call the extension office like, hey, is this it? Do I need to be worried about this?
Yeah, one? Certainly some very distinct characteristics that you can see in this. So obviously an invasive species, it has problems. You talked about that a little bit.
Yeah.
Talked about you and your volunteers are out here doing programs to help get rid of this. Obviously, I don't know that everybody wants to come out here and just pull vines. I know that may be one way, but what are some ways that y'all are working to get rid of it?
Okay. Yeah, the management plan for this thing, the Clemson University, because it was first introduced in North and South Carolina, and Clemson has done a lot of work on how to manage this thing because their dunes are literally overrun with it. And so the chemical treatments they look at, we generally recommend glyphosate over triclopyr. Now, if you get to the plant when it starts, it's kind of hard to see now because it's so woody. But when it generally starts growing, it's more herbaceous. It's more like a weed. Mm-hmm. And at that point, glyphosate is enough. And we were discussing earlier that actually you could actually do a foliar spray with that and probably get it. Or it's small enough, since it's a taproot, you can get your hoe and just literally rip it right out of the ground. Once it starts getting to the woody stage and the vines are gone, what we try to do is remove much of the material as we can. But if you've got to cut it, and usually we do, triclopyr is the herbicide we'll go with at that point. So for this, that's what we will use on this one.
Yeah, and that's a very effective product. You know.
Yeah, it seems to work.
Especially on woody type plants, woody weeds that we're dealing with, even in a pasture setting as well, yeah.
But like cogan grass and some of the others what we're dealing with around the county, there's not 100% guarantee you got it all.
Yeah.
So wherever we see it on the beach, we usually mark that in a spreadsheet. We'll come out each year. That's what the volunteers do. Come out and take a look at it. Is it there? Is it gone? Did it return? The seeds pop up in the fall. And they're gray. These flowerettes, you'll see they're about a little bit smaller than an English pea. They're kind of a smoky gray color. And each little, it's called a drupal. And each drupal actually has four seeds in it. And so there may be 10,000 seeds in a square meter right here. But we tell people at that point not to mess with it too much. If you're going to do anything, get some snips, cut it into a 5-gallon bucket so those seeds don't drop in. There are some properties here on the beach where it's actually growing along the shoreline or hanging over a fence. These seeds, if they fall in that salt water, they're viable for up to 6 months.
Oh, wow.
So the currents can carry them. Matter of fact, we believe that's how they got to the National Seashore on the other side. They've got 22 sites over there.
Very good.
Yeah.
Well, again, discussing many of these invasive plants that we deal with here in Florida throughout NISAW week. We hope you've enjoyed today's video. As always, if you have questions, you see something, feel free to reach out to your county extension office, and we hope to see you on the next video.
All right, let's do it.